Very tempting today to launch into a great sermon about that struggle between David and King Saul. There's a lot of material there. Also tempting to do a very fine sermon on fundraising. You can't get better material than you have in Paul's letter to the Corinthians. Did you notice how that was worded? So well done. Not that you'll be hard-pressed, but that there might be quality. Your plenty will supply, and on and on. Oh yeah, and Jesus became poor to make you rich, just so you know. So those are tempting, but the gospel calls, and we really need to look at the gospel, because you really don't care that much about Jonathan and David and Saul, and you probably aren't really looking for a sermon on fundraising this morning. But you might want to know how you have prayer answered. And that's what Jesus was doing in the gospel. I wish I could give you all the answers, but it isn't so simple. We all know that there have been times when we've prayed and seen that our prayers don't seem to be answered. And we might know that there are times when we pray and it appeared that our prayers were answered. And we'd like to know what it is that makes that happen. Humans are like that. We always look to see patterns of events in life. And when we discover a pattern, we want to repeat that. I was with a family once where they talked about, this was the third death in the family, so they were good enough, because people believe that death comes in threes. I said, oh, when were the others? Well, the first two were 9 and 10 years ago, and this is the third one. And I'm thinking, okay, well, the next one might be tomorrow. I didn't say that. But we do look for patterns, and that's a natural and a good thing. If we didn't look for patterns, we wouldn't do the things that we do. We wouldn't have discovered all we've discovered. We wouldn't know what we know, because the patterns teach us all those things. About prayer. I spoke to you a few weeks ago about a friend we had, Trevor Howard, and his journey of faith and the marvelous events in that. If you missed that sermon, it's on YouTube. You can go listen to it. He told us once of his trip from India to the UK on board ship, during which his daughter fell grievously ill of a fever. He was a man of the word, and he knew the scriptures, and he knew that God could heal. So he prayed, and he prayed, and he prayed, and his daughter grew worse. And it looked like she was not going to make it. And he kept praying, and she still got worse. And finally, Trevor said, okay, God, I give up. She's yours. Take her, heal her, whatever you're going to do. I gave up. And from that moment, she rallied. And she was healed. She was restored. And then years later, we met her. So yes, she did recover. When Trevor told us that story, it reminded me of one of the young people in our group, when we were in our young people's group. It was after, he was a young man by this point, too young, to know what he was doing. He got into the car with the wrong people, and they were speeding and went off the road. The driver was killed. This was before seatbelts. The person in the middle went through the windshield and ended up in the field okay. But our friend in the passenger seat was badly injured, lots of damage done to his body. And the Medical staff didn't know if they could save him. He was in a coma. And his mother sat beside his hospital bed and prayed. And prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed, hoping that he would be healed. And there was no spark, no sign, nothing, no improvement. And finally she said, "Lord, I give up. He's yours, take him or not. What can I do?" And he came out of his coma that day. That sounds like a pattern. But it doesn't always work. We had another friend who was a very powerful leader in the church, great preacher, a great man of prayer, who discovered he had melanoma. Well, he discovered after it spread to other parts of his body. And in those days, there was no treatment. And we prayed and prayed and prayed, and lots of people prayed for him. And how could God let a holy man die? We all prayed. And he died. And we buried him. A few days later, Shirley and I were at a camp where I was speaking. And the leaders of the camp had to leave to attend a funeral. And they came back with a story from that funeral. The man who was buried at that funeral had been at a church service 6 months before, where someone spoke in the charismatic gift of tongues that the speaker didn't know. In fact, no one in the church knew, except this one man, who, it was his mother tongue. So he heard what God was saying to him, that he would die, and God was giving him time to prepare for his family. So he did, spent the time, but didn't tell his family, told the pastor what was going on, who was able to tell our friends at the funeral. And you might think that if you got the word that you're going to die soon, that you would be waiting for it to happen, that you might bring it on yourself because it's inevitable. He died when he was driving down the street through a green light and someone came through a red and T-boned him and he died. And he was comforted before he died, knowing that God was with him, and this seemed to be part of God's plan. And so our friends came back to the camp and told us this story while we were grieving for our friend who died so inexplicably. How could God let him go? So maybe God was in that. It's hard to know, isn't it? When you pray and the prayers are answered the way you want, or the prayers are not answered the way you want, and how do you find your way through? I've heard preachers talk about what's like a tapestry. Life is like a tapestry where there's a lot of dark parts on it, and they let the gold threads shine out so brightly. When you go around to the back of the tapestry and look at the other side, it's all a mess. Doesn't say anything to you, but from the right side, it's absolutely beautiful. And that may tell us something about life. It's hard to know. So here in this passage from the Gospel today, Jesus heals two people. He's asked by Jairus to come and heal his daughter. And while they're traveling, people come and say, "Don't bother the teacher any further, your daughter has died." Jesus said, "She hasn't died, she's only sleeping." Jesus said that without ever having met the daughter. And while they're traveling, along comes a woman and touches Jesus' garment and is healed. Which is interesting in many ways, because lots of times when we're trying to find out how you achieve a miracle, how you get to the point where you get a miracle, and Jesus felt power going out from him, but he didn't know to whom it went. Wait a minute, I thought he knew everything. He knew that the daughter was not dead, but just sleeping, and yet he didn't know who it was that he just healed, just now. And the disciples laughed at him. Somebody asked me last week, did Jesus ever make people laugh? Well, that was one time they laughed at him because he's wondering who touched him. Seriously. You're in a crowd, dude. Of course somebody touched you. They're touching you all the time. That's not what Jesus meant. Who actually drew power? And so the woman confessed. And he said to her, your faith has healed you. Not, well, I'm glad I was able to help out my daughter. He said, your faith has healed you. And yet, when he went to the home of Jairus, he didn't say, Jairus, you know, your faith will look after your daughter. No. He went in. No, he went in with Peter, James, and John, the three closest of the disciples, and the parents. So those were people who all wanted the daughter to live. No doubters. The doubters chased outside. All the ones who were mourning her death chased them out. And said to the little girl, Talitha Kum, which we all know means little girl, I say to you, get up. You all knew that, right? Because it's right there. I'm sorry, I always laugh at the scriptures because there's always funny bits in there. Maybe it's just me, but Mark has to tell us, for she was 12 years of age, just in case she thought she was 3 months of age. And Jesus says, get up, and so she was able to walk around, and all of a sudden, it's a miracle. Well, it was a miracle, but not that. That's not the miracle. The healing is the miracle. She was 12. Let's not get carried away. So, in that case, it seemed to be the prayers of Jesus and those with him, and the lack of doubt that brought the girl. So sometimes we try to put all this together and figure out what is going on, what makes it possible for a miracle to take place. I'd like to know, because there are things I do know. I like to look at the world in a scientific way. I know that 1 + 1 = 2. I only work in base 10. Let's not get into base 2 or anything else. 1 + 1 = 2. I know that in base 10, 1 + 1 =... Base 2 is equal to 10, I think. But anyway, 1 + 1 = 2. 2 + 2 = 4. But it gets complicated, you know. 4 + 5 = 9. But so does 6 + 3. And 7 + 2 and 8 + 1. In fact, 13 - 4 = 9. There's more than one way to get the answer. And even when you're coming at the world from a scientific point of view, there's more than one solution. And then there are things that have no solution. Remember what I said to you on January the 9th? It's on YouTube. Quantum entanglement. I titled this sermon, Baptism and Quantum Entanglement. Or the other way around, I don't remember now. So quantum entanglement is where they take one particle, and they have two particles that are harmonized or in sync or something, and then they separate them, and if you flip this one, that one flips with it. Even if it's 100 kilometers away, the Chinese did it with one on Earth and the other one in orbit, and they could flip them together. Einstein called that spooky science. And those who work with this stuff have no idea why it works. So there are scientific things that we don't understand. And yet, those of us who like to think in scientific terms think we can nail down the spiritual things. So maybe the spiritual things sometimes are also beyond our ken. Possibly. We can't know everything. However, I believe God has called us to try to know everything, so we will keep trying. But there are times when we say, Lord, that's all I can do. And there are times when we hammer and hammer and hammer. When Martin Luther was praying for his friend Philip Melanchthon, who was dying, he says, I assaulted the gates of heaven, and they were like brass, and it kept praying, and finally Philip was healed. So there are times when we don't give up, but there are times when we really need God's help. Remember when Jesus went on the Mount of Transfiguration with those three disciples, again, Peter, James, and John? And while he was there, Moses and Elijah appeared, all this brightness and everything. They came down from the mountain, and they met a man who had a son who was possessed of a demon. And the 9 disciples that were down there said, Lord, we couldn't help. Like, what are we going to do? And Jesus said, this time can only come out by prayer and fasting. And he said to the Father, do you believe? And the Father said, yes, Lord, I believe, but help my unbelief. And that's where I am a lot of the time. I believe, Lord, help my unbelief. Again, many years ago, we had a friend, John Mosley, who said that he was in a car accident. He ended up at the bottom of three cars stacked on another, all the hot oil running down on him, badly burned, taken to the hospital. He was not a believer in God at all. And there he was, suffering greatly from all these burns. And in the middle of the night, he prayed what he called the unbeliever's prayer. God, if there is a God, help me if you can. And in the morning, he had no burns left. He was restored in the night. In the night, he saw a vision of Jesus come with a ring of fire around him. Not sure what the ring of fire was, but there it was. And he was healed. God, if there is a God, help me if you can. So maybe there is more than one way to come at prayer. As the woman reached out and touched the hem of his garment, with great faith she knew, she was absolutely certain that Christ would heal her, and Christ healed her. Or God, help me. God, if there is a God, help me if you can. Sometimes there are prayers like Peter had when he stepped out of the boat and was sinking, and he called out to Jesus for help, and Jesus came and helped him. And sometimes we pray, and the answer seems to be illness and death. And we do not understand. Maybe we'll never understand. But we won't quit trying. How do we put all that together and mean anything for us? What is the hope for us in the midst of all this uncertainty, confusion? I think it's like many of our relationships. We keep trying. We keep trying to get to know God better. Have you ever had an incident with someone you love? Where you said the wrong thing, they took it the wrong way, didn't work out so well, you brought the perfect gift which didn't suit. You ever been in that situation? Well, sometimes when we approach God, we might say the wrong thing or come the wrong way. But God is a little more gracious than sometimes we are when someone says the wrong thing to us. God is ever gracious, ever loving, and is ready to support us, encourage us, and nourish us. And our lifelong journey really is to draw closer to God. C.S. Lewis talked about miracles like this. He said it's like a game of pool. Now, many of you, I'm sure, spent endless hours in your teen years playing pool. George has, I can tell just by the look on his face. So now you can all envision the ill-lit room, the green eye shade, the low lights, the cigars, the whiskey on the side. So, not that, okay, sorry. When you play pool, if the ball travels and hits another ball, you know where the other ball is going to go. So usually when you take a shot, you know where the other ball is going to go. You know where you want it to go, but as soon as you hit the ball, you say, oh, darn, not quite right. You know right away. It's right. There are laws of physics that govern that. And C.S. Lewis said life is like a pool table. And things are predictable and they all go where they belong. And sometimes God comes and bumps the table and things go in a different direction. And he said that's like miracles. God doesn't suspend the laws of physics. It's just sometimes God intervenes in some little way. So yes, 1 plus 1 equals 2, and 2 plus 2 equals 4, and 5 plus 4 equals 9, but so does 18 minus 9. There's lots of ways to come at the answer. But through it all, we keep searching, trying to know God, trying to find God. And in that trying, from time to time, we see within the darkness of the tapestry a glint of gold thread, bringing light to us and letting us know that God is there for us, to love us. Even if we say, God, if there is a God, help me if you can't.